Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Faculty Summit. It's a real pleasure to be here to welcome you. I always think of the academic community as, in some sense, an extension of Microsoft Research because we work so closely with you and with all your students. And so without further ado, I'd like to introduce the Hot Topic session. We'll have four speakers on four hot topics. And I'm going to introduce each speaker one at a time. They'll speak for about 10 minutes, then they'll go off. And at the very end, I'll call everyone back onto stage and we can have some Q&A together. So let's start with the first speaker, Doug Berger. Doug Berger is one of our go-to people in computer architecture, and he's going to talk about the future of computer architecture for our entire industry and our entire field. Doug?
Okay. Hello, Jeanette. Well, it's great to be here. I spoke at the Faculty Summit last year, and so some of you may recognize some themes, but fortunately we've had some public announcements and we can talk a little bit more about what we're doing. So my talk today is really about how what I'm calling the second age of computing that we're in is ending. And I think this is a hot topic for the whole field because it has a lot of implications for how we get more efficient computation, faster computation, are able to solve problems, what our algorithms look like, what our systems look like, how we use computing. So if I think about where we've come from, you know, back in the old days, we really were building computers that were analog and specialized. So if I think back to the Antikythera mechanism, which was found in a shipwreck off of Greece, it was a very sophisticated analog computer, dozens of gears to compute many, many celestial positions, eclipses. They're still uncovering some of its secrets. The slide rule, early 1600s. And then as time progressed, more and more analog systems built to do computation that were direct simulacra of the physical phenomena. Very efficient in many cases, also very limited, not very programmable. And then, of course, we moved into the modern age of computing. Of course, Babbage predated this age. He was a visionary. But we really went through an era where we started to take digital computers, starting with uncomputable numbers in 1936 and a very rapid innovation that built this modern paradigm we have of digital computers, programmable with multiple stable layers of the system stack. So general purpose processors, programmed by instruction sets that started being developed in the late 50s, virtual memory, out of order execution for faster single thread performance, caches. Then we started integrating things together over a 15 year period, and that integration of course continued. We developed processors that could sit on an entire chip, integrated the caches, the floating point units, and then we started really pushing on single thread performance, ran the clock way up over a 15 year period, tried to get as much instruction level parallelism as we could, and we were getting so much improvement in energy efficiency that this was affordable. And then when that started to peter out, industry did a hard pivot and shifted to multi-core designs and started to build many cores on a chip as a way of continuing to advance programming efficiency and performance. But this whole model, what I'll call the second age of programmable, digital, deterministic in many cases, some caveats for multi-core thread interleaving computing, was very stable and it was driven by Moore's law and gave us great efficiencies. That's now in the process of ending. We're somewhere in the end game. We don't know exactly when it's going to end, but the stresses are building. And our projections are in the very near future, Moore's law will be over for economic reasons, not really physical reasons. We can probably scale lower, but it won't be affordable. So what comes after that? And it is a really big shift because this paradigm has been very stable and we've been able to have largely abstracted software that doesn't have to think very hard about the underlying machinery to continue getting more capabilities, more energy efficient devices, deploy them into ubiquitous computing, in your pocket, vision, all of this. So this next age, I think, is going to really be built on top of specialization and not just logic specialization, which I'll talk a little bit about in a moment, but other models that are specialized to the new stacks, the new algorithms that will sit above them. And so I think what we'll see initially very soon is hardware specialization and logic to keep mining efficiency out, programmable logic, new architectures, maybe statistical models of computation. But the challenge, of course, is that there's a very tough tension between generality, write software, run it everywhere, and efficiency, so that you can do more with less energy. And of course, there are many points along that spectrum, with CPUs being the most general, aggressive CPUs on one end, and then application-specific integrated circuits, fixed function hardware on the other end. And as you move towards the right of the spectrum, you get more efficient, but you also get more limited. And it's very hard to do broadly. And so we've been looking in the client and the cloud, trying to anticipate what's going to happen and build some solutions, because this disruption is now very, very close, you know, within the horizon of a research project. And the cloud, the real two main challenges is that you really want at large scale your software, your infrastructure, your servers, to be as homogeneous as possible, so that you can move services around and you're not just plunking down and fixing services. But then if you're going to build something like ASICs, as the, you know, the software changes monthly, and for ASICs to be valuable or useful, you need 2 years to design them, and then they have to be sit in the servers for 3 years for the lifetime of the server. So you build something specialized that's supposed to last for 5 years from the time you start it, and the software's flipping around and changing monthly, which makes it very hard to do specialization in the cloud with that ASIC methodology. And then the client, of course, area is still incredibly precious because of cost reasons, so you need accelerators and specialized logic to be both general and efficient. We already put ASICs onto our mobile chipsets, and so for accelerators and specialized, somewhat programmable hardware, there's something I call, you know, the uncanny valley, sort of loosely joking, making a reference to the HCI concept, is where accelerators go to die, because you do important stuff in ASICs, and then your CPUs are very general, and then you can't find enough useful stuff to do in that middle to make programmable accelerators work. So these are hard problems. So we have some really exciting work in both spaces that I think has legs, but we're able actually now to talk about the cloud part of it. And so Harry referred to the project that my team and Bing and others in MSR have partnered on. And the idea is that today we have a programmable software fabric. These are servers, you know, running software on CPUs, and you connect them via networks, you know, through a top of rack and cluster switch hierarchy. And what we've really added, or I think the right view of what we added, is a second fabric, which you can also almost think of as an independent data center of programmable logic or programmable hardware. And so the idea is here is you will write part of your services in hardware and deploy it on this second fabric and get a big efficiency boost. But because the hardware is programmable, we're using FPGAs, you're able to change it on the fly. And so as your services change, you can update them. Obviously, there's a huge programmability and tools challenge. But I should point out that the end of Moore's Law will drive the need for new system stacks. So this doesn't affect just the architects, but how you write programming languages, how the runtime and operating system allocates resources, which algorithms you choose to design. And so these whole stacks are going to change. And they're going to change pretty rapidly to get continued innovation. And so this is our take on this stack for the cloud. And of course, in our specific design that we published in ISCA, you know, you have PCIe connections going down from the software fabric to the hardware fabric. And you see those little bumps there. Those are secondary networks that tie FPGAs together, so that you can deploy services across multiple chips at once. And so we published this a few months ago in ISCA, and what we demonstrated was that for adding about a 10% power increase to the servers with this hardware fabric, we can actually cut the number of servers needed to run Bing ranking in half, saving a tremendous amount of cost and overall energy, and actually getting better throughput, being able to run larger models. And the Bing ranking stack is a very complicated software stack. So the intent here was to show that you could actually rewrite large services in hardware. And you know, some people on my team, Andrew is on assignment, unfortunately, but Eric and Adrian will be talking about aspects of the system. I think one talk today and one talk tomorrow. So I encourage you to check those out if you're interested. OK, but looking forward, you know, we're at this transition point for the field. And what are we going to do next? What are our options? I mean, of course, we'll continue to try to refine processors and come up with better architectures. We'll always be writing software. But what are the big drivers of capabilities going to be? So we're taking a big bet on hardware specialization. I think we can do that now. In fact, we are doing it now. And that looks very tractable, both economically and in terms of the gains you get. But there's more out there, because that of course will have its limits too, because you're still dealing with the same silicon substrate, it's just a different programming model. So there's a lot of really exciting work in approximate computing, fuzzy results. You know, last year I talked about some work we'd done on neural processing units with our colleagues at Washington and Georgia Tech. But the idea here is that you go back to analog, you start building circuits that can have fuzzy results, and there's a lot you can do there, especially if you transform programs into new representations. Okay, and then of course neural computing, not running neural nets in software or even on deterministic hardware, but actually building neuromorphic hardware and trying to understand these neural patterns and treat that as a programming stack. I think that's really exciting, but that's a ways out. Krista is going to be talking about quantum computing next. Also looks very promising. You know, computing with biology, both, you know, trying to get organisms to do things, custom organisms. But this is all, and then maybe even computing with ecologies even farther out. And now we're playing at the long-term guessing game here. But an interesting thing to note here is that all of these models below hardware specialization are in some sense statistical. You know, your results are going to vary with the exception of quantum computing. So that may be, I think, of the list of candidates that we've looked at, that seems to be the only one that might actually provide, again, additionally deterministic execution with a huge gain in capabilities. And so if you're going to go statistical and do these other things, we need very different stacks. You know, different mathematics, different algorithms, different languages, different compilers, and of course different computing substrates. I won't even call it hardware. Okay, thank you.
Great, yeah. So thank you, Doug. Our next speaker is Krista Svore, who will be talking to us about quantum computing. She manages the Quantum Architectures and Computation Group, and Harry already teed her up. So Krista?
Thank you, Jeanette. Hello, everyone. I'm going to talk about quantum computing and the work we're doing here at Microsoft Research, as well as with our academic partners around the world. So quantum computing has appeared a lot in the news recently. Many, many articles appearing. We've heard about the D-Wave device, for example, in the news. And as Harry mentioned, even most recently, an article on topological quantum computing and the work being done at Station Q and Quark here at Redmond in Microsoft Research. What do we need to actually have a quantum computer? As Doug mentioned, we hope quantum computing is one of the new computational paradigms that can really change what we can actually compute today. Well, we obviously need a hardware architecture. There, we're looking for a fully programmable quantum computer that is scalable and also fault tolerant. We also need a software architecture, and this is a big focus of our work here at Microsoft Research in Redmond. There, we want to be able to compile and optimize complex quantum algorithms onto the actual hardware, the quantum device. And finally, or perhaps most importantly, we actually need problems that we want to solve on a quantum computer. We need quantum algorithms that can be performed on small to large scale quantum devices. And they need to really attack problems that we can't solve classically. So in terms of hardware, we have lots of options. There's lots of devices that have been proposed, from ion traps to superconducting qubits, to optical systems, quantum dots, and then a big focus of Station Q's work, topological qubits. I'm not going to talk a lot about the technologies today, because tomorrow we actually have a focus session where we'll hear more about these different hardware technologies. In terms of the software architecture, this is a big focus of our group here in Redmond. We have a system called Liquid, which is really a quantum software architecture that allows programming of a quantum device. You can actually target the circuits for various purposes. And we also have a state-of-the-art simulator, which allows you to actually simulate up to around 30 qubits just on 32 gigs of RAM. So that's really a state-of-the-art simulation tool. And Liquid, again, there's going to be a demo of Liquid tomorrow afternoon, and Dave Wecker's going to speak about Liquid in the quantum session tomorrow as well. So today I want to really focus on the algorithms. Why do we even care about quantum computing? What will it give us? Well, in fact, this is a conjectured alignment of the complexity classes. If you think about what we do classically, you know, we focus on problems that lie in P, that are efficient to solve, polynomial scaling. You can think of BQP as the quantum analog of P, and you can think of QMA as the quantum analog of NP. So what do we know? What problems do we want to solve on a quantum computer? Well, we want to find problems that lie in BQP, in this green, larger green circle, that are outside of P, that we can't solve classically efficiently. We actually have instances of this, which is why we think quantum computing is so promising. So one instance, many people have heard about Shor's algorithm. This is a quantum algorithm that can break RSA cryptosystem, for example. It solves factorization. This lies in NP, an intersection of NP. The Shor's algorithm lies in BQP. So it can be checked classically efficiently, but we don't have an efficient classical algorithm to actually perform factorization. Shor's algorithm gives us this on a quantum computer. We also have another really interesting example of a quantum, efficient quantum algorithm, namely the simulation of physical systems. So quantum simulation also lies in BQP. These are problems that, simulating problems that we can't actually solve classically in, the lifetime of the universe. But we can potentially solve in seconds to hours, maybe a few days on a quantum computer. So what do we really want to do with a quantum computer? We want to find more algorithms. We want to find more algorithms that lie in BQP that are outside of P. So as I've mentioned, we have several wins already in this space. You know, going back to Feynman, he's the one that proposed simulation of physical systems on a quantum computer back in 1982. There, we can achieve exponential speedups over what we can do classically. We also have solving linear systems of equations can be done on a quantum computer exponentially faster than on a classical computer. And then, as I mentioned, we have problems in cryptography. For example, Shor's algorithm that can be done exponentially faster on a quantum computer than a classical computer. So we have several different wins, and what I want to focus on today is talking a little bit more about quantum simulation. There we have some really exciting new results showing that this can actually be done very efficiently on a quantum computer. So let's think about quantum chemistry. So for quantum chemistry, what we want to do is we want to simulate the molecular dynamics of a system larger than what we can do classically, or to higher accuracy. So we want to use a quantum computer to do this, and we want to solve the system ideally exactly. So currently, we know that roughly a third of supercomputer usage is actually dedicated to performing these types of problems, to actually simulating problems in quantum chemistry or also material science. This actually requires the simulation of an exponential size Hilbert space, which means classically we're really limited to simulating systems that have roughly, say, 50 to 70 spin orbitals. On a quantum computer, we can actually move to many more spin orbitals. We can simulate the molecular dynamics actually using a quantum simulation. And what this means is, on a quantum computer, we can actually simulate, you know, hundreds of spin orbitals. The runtime, what's really exciting here, what I want to mention, is the recent progress in this space. In particular, work by Quark and Station Q at Microsoft Research, in collaboration with various academic partners, we've been able to show that the quantum algorithm for quantum simulation, in particular for problems in quantum chemistry, is actually now practical. It's becoming a killer app, similar to what we would think of as Shor's algorithm. So previously, back in December, the scaling was order n to the 11, where n is the number of spin orbitals, on a quantum computer. So while this is polynomial time, the degree is very high. And for an interesting problem, say, you know, 100 spin orbitals, this means it would still take 300 million years on a quantum computer. That doesn't really seem practical, even though that's better than the long, you know, the age of the lifetime of the universe on a classical computer. 300 million years still isn't practical. But recent work among Quark, Station Q, and our academic colleagues has actually shown, just in the last couple weeks, they've shown that they can actually perform algorithmic optimizations and improve the error scaling such that now this algorithm for quantum simulation of quantum chemistry actually now scales something more like n to the sixth, somewhere between n to the four and n to the sixth. This means something that was 300 million years on a quantum computer now is down to, for a reasonable clock speed, roughly a couple hours, 9 hours, or maybe even several seconds for some problems. So this is really now a practical algorithm for a quantum computer and can solve things we really can never do on a classical system, ever. So this is really exciting, but why do we care about quantum chemistry? Well, one application, for example, is nitrogen fixation. Say we want to find a catalyst that allows us to convert nitrogen to ammonia, and we want to do this at room temperature. The current process for this is the Haber process. It was developed in the early 1900s, and in fact, it uses very, very high temperatures, 400 degrees Celsius, for example, and high pressures. It actually uses 3 to 5% of the world's natural gas production to perform this process. Natural gas provides the hydrogen in this case. So could we use a quantum computer to simulate the reaction pathways between the catalyst and nitrogen to actually find a more efficient, a more inexpensive way to produce fertilizer? This could really help the world's food production, lower the cost of it, and it would also reduce the amount of energy required to produce such fertilizer. Well, we think with this quantum simulation algorithm, this could be done with just, say, 100 to 200 qubits. Similarly, we can use the quantum algorithm to do something like carbon capture. This would help prevent global warming. Again, finding a catalyst that would enable us to extract carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, which is a big problem due to fossil fuel production, also aircraft and automobile emission. So this could actually help with a real world problem with just a couple hundred qubits, say 200 to 400. So in summary, we have a couple killer applications now for a quantum computer in the areas of quantum simulation and also cryptography. We believe that these methods can be extended in quantum simulation to help us find, for example, a high temperature superconductor. This might require a couple thousand qubits. We're also looking into areas where we can use quantum computing to improve machine learning. Harry mentioned this morning the role of deep learning and other learning systems. Can we actually use quantum computing and harness interference and other characteristics of quantum computers to produce better inference models? So this is a big question we're addressing here in our groups at Microsoft Research. So if you want to learn more, tomorrow we have the quantum session, and here's some links to our group's websites. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Krista. Doug is, I often think of him as our go-to person in computer architecture, and I think of Krista as our go-to person in quantum. And it's pretty exciting the kinds of truly breakthrough results they are publishing and sharing with everyone. Our next speaker is Desni Tan. Desni Tan runs the Computational User Experiences Group here, and he's going to talk about mobilizing healthcare. Desni?
Thanks. I thought I'd come out and present a call to arms for us to participate in this healthcare revolution that we're facing today. We care a lot about our cars, and we've worked really hard to make sure these things continue to run smoothly and don't break down on us. In fact, if you pop your car open today, you'll see hundreds and hundreds of sensors all working invisibly on your behalf, not requiring a whole lot of attention, but getting nicely presented to you on this in-car dash. So on the dash, you have your odometer, your speedometer, your tachometer, giving you real-time performance feedback so that you can track the here and now of your car. Lately, we've got a whole bunch of hazard lights, warning lights. You've got your check engine light, you've got your check tire pressure light, your fuel temperature, your brake system, your airbags, and so on and so forth. Warning of potential hazards so that you can preempt any catastrophic breakdown. We want to fix this machine before it breaks down. Lately, we've even allowed the upload or download of these of this data into our phones and our computers in order to run apps that allow us to optimize our behavior. make us safer drivers or more fuel-efficient drivers. This trend has been pervading various of our systems, so cars, airplanes, offices, our homes, our factories, our malls. We think it's about time we take this and apply it to the machine that we probably care the most about, our bodies. I don't think I have to spend a whole lot of time convincing you that it's a worthy effort to help people live healthier for longer. I don't even think I have to convince you that we can do this for cheaper, and that would also be a worthwhile effort. If you look at the stats, the US spends $2.8 trillion a year on healthcare. $2.8 trillion, that's a really big number. Just to get my head wrapped around it, I did a little bit of math. This is 11 million homes on the West Coast. I had started in the state of Washington, but there aren't 11 million homes in the state. We could buy 6 billion Xboxes, which would sort of be a wonderful thing for the company. We could buy the top 10 most valuable companies in the US and still have money left over. So this is just a massive, massive number. Worse yet, if you look at the trends, you know, this was 5% of our GDP spent on healthcare in 1960, 18% today, and if you look at the projections, by about 2050, we will be spending, if we continue on this trajectory we're on, greater than a third of our GDP on healthcare. The good news, well, maybe not so good news, but we spend $3 out of every $4 on managing chronic conditions. This is actually really bad news. But the good part of that is that a bunch of that is projected to be preventable waste, and that's where we come in. The approach we're going to propose is based on a very simple engineering tenet that we cannot improve what we cannot measure. And so the task at hand then, as Harry alluded to earlier, is really to be able to sense and measure and in fact digitize a bunch of relevant health metrics. Because as soon as we do this, we as computer scientists can start to compute. And as soon as we can start to compute, we have a shot at solving the core of the problem, the goal of detecting, diagnosing, managing, predicting, and eventually preventing disease entirely. And this prevention is what's going to be the cure for our healthcare problem. The move is really one from intuitive cookbook medicine, loose subjective observations for diagnosis, therapies with amazingly unclear efficacy for treatment, into a data-centric precision medicine, precise objective data that we're measuring, evidence-based treatment that is predictive, that is personalized, and that we continue to track and iterate on. From a technology perspective, there are a bunch of challenges. One, obviously, is how do you continuously capture health-relevant data anywhere, everywhere, and all the time. Bunch of challenges here. So smaller, cheaper sensors and devices in convenient and ideally desirable form factors. Once we have those, we have to operate under amazingly scarce resource. These things are shrinking. They're getting smaller and smaller. They're getting put all over the place. Power, network, and in fact, human attention are amazingly scarce, and we sort of have to deal with those things fairly explicitly. Little plug for a session. So there is an impossibly small devices session that I'll be chairing with four wonderful speakers later today in the Cascade Room. Now, to be fair, there has been an explosion of wearable biosensing devices, especially in the startup landscape. It seems like every other day, in fact, every day, there are five or six new devices launching. Stuff you put on your wrists, stuff you put on your chest, stuff you put on your head, stuff you put on your legs, stuff you wear, stuff you stick on. These things are all over the place. And it's a really exciting landscape. Now, unfortunately, if you look a little bit more closely, you'll see that 90% of these are failing to engage the consumer and failing to deliver any real improvement. Too many pedometers and too many heart rates getting deployed out there. But that is the nature of that business, and that is an exciting thing for us to track. Now, the challenge for us in this room, then, is that research must kind of run ahead of that game and deliver much deeper innovation. If we treat the body as a generator of big data, and you'll see big data tossed around a lot during the course of this summit, but if we treat the body as a prolific generator of this big data, then it's really our challenge as a community to reconsider, to discover, to invent new metrics that are going to be relevant to interesting health outcomes and prevention of those of diseases. If you look at the body of work, in fact, my group had set out to do this initially, there's too many of us replicating in new form factors everything we already know in the clinical space. If you look historically at the set of things we measure them largely because they were easy to measure 100, 200, 300 years ago. And we've built up large bodies of literature and large amounts of expertise around these sensors. But today, we've got a whole bunch of new sensors. We've got a whole bunch of new technologies. We know more about the human body than we've ever known in the course of history. It is our job in this room and with our colleagues to really go in and reinvent the things we measure about the body. Now, obviously, it doesn't stop there. There's a whole bunch of stuff we have to do even post, even after being able to sense these interesting new metrics. We start to have to be able to aggregate these multiple devices in the environment. We have to be able to start to aggregate the data. We have to build systems that facilitate real discovery with this data. We obviously have to explore privacy, security, reliability. This is an amazingly sensitive pot of data, as are all the others we deal with. And there's some real innovation to be had there. And then on top of that, we have to design engaging experiences that make consumers, patients, doctors, providers want to really engage in this new movement and create some real behavior change. More plugs for more sessions. This kind of gets strewn throughout the faculty summit. Connected devices session later today. The genomic software revolution. This is another big piece of the puzzle. Also later today, unfortunately, those happen at the same time. As Harry alluded to, the Design Expo, making sense of what happens when we've got all this data streaming in from a billion, 10 billion, 100 billion, a trillion sensors that we're going to put in the environments. Science in the cloud. In fact, if you look through the program, just about every session has relevant content to this topic. So in quick conclusion, I do believe that we are sitting on the verge of a healthcare revolution. We will have for our bodies what we today have for our cars and our offices and our homes. We'll have wearable sensors, embeddable sensors, strewn throughout the environment, measuring all sorts of data. We're going to turn healthcare into a data surveillance problem, or at least parts of it. We're going to take disease. We're going to be able to better detect, diagnose, delay, and even prevent diseases entirely. And we'll look back, 10, 15, 20 years from now, we'll look back and wonder how we got away for so long thinking about sickness rather than wellness. We'll look back trying to figure out why it was that it took us this long to digitize the healthcare system and start to think about preventive healthcare. As a community, I truly believe that we have the tools with us to make this happen. And if we believe that we can fundamentally improve healthcare, I think we have a responsibility to. So let's go do it. Thank you.
Thank you. As you heard from Harry this morning, we in Microsoft Research have expanded our horizons to include the kind of areas that you're familiar with in terms of computing, computer science, and so on, to hiring economists like Preston McAfee and social scientists like Duncan Watts. Our next speaker is trained in anthropology, she got her PhD in communications. She's one of our social scientists in our New England lab, and she's going to speak to us, Mary Gray, about people are crowds. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I want to talk about what I think is a revolutionary moment in social science, and particularly for anthropology, my field, because I think we're at the moment where we can think about crowds and the specificity of individual lives in them, and at the same time use the computational power of computer science to explore patterns that we've never thought about before. So As a way of thinking through this, my collaborator, Sid Suri, and I are doing a project looking at crowdsourcing, but specifically thinking about the people behind and in the crowd. We're all familiar with crowd work. Many of you are probably reliant on crowd work to do your projects. We have some beautiful examples of the application of human computation through Jeff Bingham's work with VizWiz. There's a lot of citizen science that happens through crowdsourcing, so mapping of neurons through the project iWire. As crowdsourcing increasingly contributes to the expansion of automation and AI, we argue that crowd work could, perhaps it should, and it must become an employment opportunity for the future. So, if we're going to study crowds, if we need to really understand them in a social way, how do we get at them? They're massive. And they're arguably not just a technological system, they're a social system, an expansive one. So it's not just human labor, it's also social connections, the economic transactions that are constantly happening, all the regulatory regimes that shape what sort of work can happen. And it's also distributed computation. What kinds of tools do we need? And this, to me, is the revolution. We need to be able to bring together computer science and its capacity for mapping nodes, people, and those edges. I would argue those relationships and a network. But we need to connect it to the kind of ethnography and anthropological material that tells us about the variety of nodes that are out there, the individuals, the institutions that aren't really something we can grasp from mapping it. From afar, and then the meaning of those edges, which we can really only get through the context in which somebody is in the moment that we're seeing them enter our system from up above. And the most important piece I want you to take away from this is that context, that social context, and a longitudinal view matter the most in what we're doing. So I'd also argue it takes a pretty interdisciplinary team. I'm not just working with Sid. We're doing a book project together. We'll be spending at least another 6 months, possibly a year. I don't know if he can escape me, working on this project. But we've had mathematicians, econometrics. We've had communication, development studies, sociology, and engineering and system design contributing to this project. The methodology is pretty unique in that we're trying to integrate, not just sit siloed side by side, but truly integrate five different data sets. One is the ethnographic field work. In fact, tomorrow I'm going back to India. I really have no idea what time zone I'm in right now. The second is metadata from servers, and we've had a lot of generous support from our internal platform partner, UHRS, but also from a startup, MobileWorks, and from Amara, a nonprofit, who are willing to share their back-end data with us to help us make sense of the workflows that are online. But we're also using system-level measurements, experiments, and other ways of establishing the geolocations of the workers that we're working with. To ask them quick questions about, say, their sampling habit, their purchasing habits, to also recruit them for the ethnographic work. And then ongoing survey work, and lastly, textual analysis of the forums that many of these workers use to collaborate. So let me show you a couple of examples of the data set. This first one is an example of a mapping task that we put out on Amazon Mechanical Turk, and it was a way to be able to find out who are the people in this one particular task and where are they located by asking them to self-report that information. And we went back to the crowd, went back to this platform and asked that question again, and we sent out that request to folks who had already done the task to get a kind of variability or get a reliability to the response rate that we had to be able to have a sense of where are people located in this world. We could just look at IP addresses, but as many of you know, if we were trying to map India, the IP addresses would send us all over the map. And in fact, when I started my fieldwork in India, that was the first thing I learned, is that every IP address we had that was reported was wrong. And we were able to verify it when we interviewed somebody, and they could tell us, actually, I've never been to Mumbai. I live in Chennai. Right? So self-reported IP addresses became more accurate than the metadata. So the crowd that you're seeing in this data map, we used to create another data set. interviews in the locations where we knew we had a concentration of crowd workers. As an anthropologist, I would have never known where to look for the crowd. This is a needle in a haystack. I can't just go to India or another country and put out a want ad and say, can I talk to anybody who's doing crowd work? So this is an incredibly robust tool for me as an ethnographer. What we've found through those two different data sets and our other materials is that we have a really robust amount of collaboration happening that's completely not detectable by our systems. People are creating ways to put the collaboration, the peer consultation that we're used to in our daily lives and work back into their crowd work. So even though crowdsourcing assumes anonymous, autonomous workers, workers end up creating and really, in many ways, drawing on existing networks. And we're going to talk more about that in our panel on Tuesday. They talk via phone. They call each other up in the middle of the night and tell each other about good gigs that have come in the system. They share requesters lists. They're often working in family units, so they're sharing a single IP. So all of these are important details that we never would have known without combining both the what we can draw from the computational power of doing the systems level analysis and the power of doing ethnographic work. So what we find is that crowds are actually networks of individual, and they're often in very particular social and cultural contexts that shape what kind of work they're able to do. That presents two key challenges for us, and I think this is, to me, not just for us, but the challenges that any effort to combine social science and computer sciences will face. First, we tend to zoom too far out when we're studying social media, and we often just lump what we see into an aggregate. This is by far, and I think I'm very happy to say most of my peers at MSR Research are they're very attentive to this, and I'm looking at one particularly who's very good at it, Susan, of not doing this. But I think right now our habit right now is to look for the masses of tweets, to look for the masses of posts. And in doing that, we tend to homogenize people's experiences. The second is the uncharted territory of how to ethically study online media. And I'm going to point out that we have a really exciting session at 11:30 till 12:30 in the Baker Room to talk about the ethical implications of thinking about data science as human subjects research. Because, my friends, I think that's where we're at. When we study social media, most people experience social media as interaction. That means we're interacting with people when we do things like data mining, perhaps. And so I think that's the important conversation to have, is that this sort of work brings a new expectation, an uncharted expectation of ethical obligations to the people that we're studying, our users. But I also have some other ethical obligations to point out to you that are particular to ethnographic work. So, for example, in the field, I met women who were doing crowd work, Muslim women who were expected to stay in the home, who were often doing that work without necessarily the support of their families, and in some cases, not the knowledge of their families. In those cases, I have a very particular ethical obligation to those women in terms of protecting their privacy, but also supporting their opportunities to continue doing the work that they're doing. The second example I have there is helping workers who are finding out that their accounts are being suspended by Amazon Mechanical Turk. They have no idea why. I don't consider it somehow not my business to be completely unavailable to them, so I make myself available to them to help them try and figure out what's going on. That's part of the ethical obligation of anthropological research. So I would argue that ethnographic approaches and CS can help each other a lot. A lot. If Harry pointed out that the future of what we have to work on is making sense of the little amount of time that users have to use devices, then we have to be thinking about what are the social lives and identities that make the uses that people put tools to matter to them. So we can't just build tools with the expectation of what people should be doing with them. We have to pay attention to what are they actually doing with them. And how do their social identities as mothers, as parents, as friends, as citizens affect how they use the tools that we provide for them, particularly if we're thinking about their work lives? And then lastly, thinking about the social contexts and identities that are going to significantly shape their access to technologies. So in some cases, meeting Muslim workers who are using crowd work as a way of getting around the discrimination they face in the workplace, or women who are able to contribute because they're working from home. So I'd argue that this attention to context and time are critical. And they're going to allow us to pay attention to the dimensions that will make what we build matter more. And that looking at these connections will be the way to shape the future of technologies, but also to shape the future of social change in our relationship to them. Thanks.
You want to stay up?
Okay, now we're going to have a session, a Q&A session. I'm going to call the panelists back up, Doug, Krista, Desney. And we have about 10 minutes for questions and answers. I'd like to ask the audience for any questions that you might want to ask. Yes. Wait for the mic, please.
Yeah. Hello, I'm Shishmita. I have a question for Krista. You mentioned about these applications for quantum computing. First of all, quantum computing, the algorithms that you have are probabilistic in nature. So when you say that you're bringing down big O of n to the power 11 down to n to the power 4 or so, the level of accuracy also matters, which means how many rounds of measurements do you have to do? Have those been taken into account when you're doing the simulation?
Yeah, so for these algorithms, as you mentioned, thank you for your question. Quantum algorithms are, by nature probabilistic. So we have to repeat the computation in order to get the answer out with high probability. There's in these quantum chemistry and these simulation algorithms, there's two levels of accuracy. There's the accuracy to which you want to find the ground state. So for example, to millihartree or microhartree. So that's going to require maybe, a higher degree polynomial as you go to higher and higher accuracy. So I quoted numbers for the millihartree case. But then you would repeat the algorithm, many times to get a right answer. In this case, I think 9 hours would include those repetitions. But if you have many quantum computers, you can do that in parallel. You don't have to. When we have a cluster of quantum computers.
when we get a quantum computer. Thank you, Krista. Over there? Is that Todd?
Yes. I have a question for Doug Berger. Hi, Doug. The last thing on your list for future computing paradigms was either environmental or ecological computing. Can you talk some more about that?
Well, obviously, it's the one farthest out on the list. The question was ecological computing. If you look at the impact that computing is having over populations, to Mary's talk, we're changing the way people act every day. We're talking about healthcare. So we're starting to couple things more with how we behave and with organisms. And if you look at the ecological challenges we have in terms of sustainability, just keeping the climate set, rapid extinction of species, we're whacking out the underpinnings of these food chains. How do we solve that? And I think if we think about what we do as computer scientists, as we start to move towards large statistical models, trying to keep populations stable, trying to keep food chains stable, that's going to be really hard. And I think computer scientists have a lot to offer there. Obviously, it's a long-term problem. But I can't think of a more important problem to work on. And I think we uniquely have some of the tools to tackle it.
Thanks. You, Doug. Question? Is that Dave?
It's Joe Traub.
Oh, Jeanette. Joe. Okay, sorry, Joe. Yeah.
Thanks, Jeanette. My question is for Desney. If you get any prescription, there'll be a long list of the unintended consequences are often very scary. I know part of that is the companies don't want to be sued. So they already warn you about that. But there really are unintended consequences to a lot of pharma. Have you thought about how to reduce those?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. It's actually a couple of things we can do to start to reduce those. Obviously, as I point out, the genomics, the associated genomics revolution, I think, is going to help us a lot with sort of personalizing treatments and predicting what particular treatments will do to particular people in particular contexts. The other is, even if we don't sort of catch all of that, there's a bunch of work, that Eric Horvitz and his collaborators are doing here at Microsoft Research that are looking at how you better detect those once they've happened. So as an example, you know, he's done a very clever thing looking at search logs and predicting drug interactions. You just can't, you know, combinatorics don't allow you to go test every single, you know, pair of drugs or triad of drugs. But if you start seeing stuff show up in search logs, you know, medication A, medication B, throwing up, you can start to infer these and really go target the things you test in the real world a little bit more. So I think these computational tools are going to start to build up. They're really causing us to think about things like drug efficacy and drug interactions in very different ways. And if you look across the board in healthcare, I think you see that happening in each of these buckets. It has traditionally been very hard.
Very good. Do you have a question for Mary? Yes. It's coming, the mic.
Thank you. It's a question for Mary and to some extent Desney, but it's a combination. I was struck by the flow from one of your talks to another, and Mary, especially by your comment that you have to understand people's social lives and identity to build better tools for them. So that guy next to you is building better tools for us, so I understand. I do a bit of work in the healthcare world, and it's as much social. I mean, I hate to tell you, Desney, it's not all biology and chemistry, especially for people with chronic diseases, especially for people at the young end of the spectrum and the older edge of the spectrum. So do you guys talk?
Ironically, this morning we were saying we should talk. So literally, this morning we were sitting down and we were before the session saying, you know, there's so many implications to the, you know, thinking about the quantified self movement, for example, thinking about the ways in which we're deeply interested in the data that we're collecting, but it's never, we don't have longitudinal tests or longitudinal studies, for example, to tell us how long do people stick with it. What do they do with that material? Like, we look for about 2 or 3 weeks, maybe 4 months, 5 months. How about 10 years? You know, what would it look like to think about this for 5 years? We actually could do a 3-year study at this point and think about what are the implications of that for how that would change what we would fundamentally address. Yeah, we're starting to talk.
Yeah, thanks for pointing out that I very conveniently swept all the complexities of healthcare under the rug. But you're absolutely right. I mean, this is part technological, it's part policy and regulatory, it's part social, and there are many complex moving pieces that we do have to consider in the process of innovating here.
One thing you didn't say, the word doctor in your, this is for Desney, because even though we may have a bunch of sensors and a whole bunch of things may be coming, but the doctor, I'll trust him much more. And you didn't mention the doctor at all.
Yeah, the doctor is a great point. The doctor is critical in this revolution. They are not going away. We are not replacing doctors with technology. I think what we will serve to do is arm doctors with better tools so that they can essentially focus their time on the 10% of tasks that are the most critical tasks and sort of relegate to, you know, all the routine collections and what have you to the technology. It's something that comes up every time. We've got lots of clinical partners, and the first question when we chat with a new partner is, well, does this make my job go away? And the answer, I think, is very clearly no. It shifts it significantly, and we really have to think about it very differently. But again, for the same reasons that this is not a technological solution, there are social things that doctors do and nurses and the whole provider system. So I think you're right. It is, again, part of that really complex ecosystem. And we will, in my estimation, fundamentally shift the task of doctors. And the analogy I use is sort of pilots, right? The sort of fly-by-feel piloting that we used to do versus a very much more automated system today where the pilot is still critical, but in a very different way.
We'll take one streaming question for Mary. Besides privacy and ethics, how do you account for, I assume, there's words missing on the slide. How do you account for skewed behavior as many people will be guaranteed?
I think guarding.
Guarding their activity and what they discuss online. How do you solve for that?
It's a really important question because I think in many ways it goes to the point that depending on the question, because it always depends on the question, right? That there are many cases where it won't be enough to stop at the screen. It's going to be a case where we'll have what we're seeing when we're looking at social media. We're seeing what people imagine they should be saying often. Sometimes we're getting what they may not want some people to see and others to see. So for certain questions, that might be enough. For many questions, what we really want to get at is seeing them in their everyday context, their everyday life, to see, well, what is it they're speaking to when we don't see what else is visible on the screen? Who are they speaking to, say, on the schoolyard and when they're communicating something online? So I do think this is also a delicate ecosystem. And in some ways, the more guarded people become when they're going online because they think they have to be kind of adversarial with platforms, that they have to kind of protect their information because we don't ask for it, we take it. The harder it will be for data scientists to really make sense of what we see online. It'll probably become even more pressing for people like me to be able to rebuild up trust so that we get a chance to talk with people about what these different technologies mean to them. And one last note on that, one of the conversations we had was, we often think about this as online without thinking about mobile. Like, what does it mean to be carrying these devices throughout our day, throughout our worlds, interacting with each other? So I think the ethics are less about privacy and more about trust. What does it look like to rebuild our sense of trust?
Great note to end on.